The purpose of this was we are participating in statewide celebration of the Thoreau bicentennial, bicentennial of his birth, which I think was July. Mm-hmm. But we're celebrating it all year, all across the state. The Walden Woods Project, there's some information about it up here. They wanted to get every city and town in Massachusetts to participate in some way. So we said, sure, we'd love to be part of that project. We're having tonight's lecture. We also had a nature walk for families on that Rough Meadows Wildlife Sanctuary, which is a gem if you haven't been there. It's we call it from forest to salt marsh, and that's literally what you do. And when you come out into the marsh and the vistas, and it's just stunning. So that was great. We have a classical guitar concert coming up. That's free. A local person named Scott Ouellette, who's performed here a couple times before. There's some flyers if you want to look on your way out. That's November 18th, which is a Saturday. Our Friends at the Library basket raffle is coming up. It'll be mid-November to mid-December, which is very, very fun. We have festive baskets on display that you can buy chances for. Am I forgetting anything, Jenny?
I'm trying to think of something off of my head.
Yeah.
I think you've covered everything.
Okay. So,
yeah.
And rallylibrary.org is the place to keep up with all of our happenings. You can sign up for our newsletter, which goes out once a month.
There's a calendar, so everything's put on the calendar.
Yep.
If anything new pops up.
Yep. Now that you've all introduced yourself to John, this is John, Dr. John Kagg, who's from UMass Lowell. He's written a lovely book called American Philosophy, A Love Story. It got some honors, including NPR Best Book of the Year, New York Times Editor Choice. The Times review is excellent. It really, it made me want to read it, honestly. It's such a good summary, and it's just enough of a story to say, I need to find out what happens here. And then Kirkus gave it a star, I guess. Mm-hmm. But, more about John. He's an expert in American philosophy and the whole history of the Transcendentalists and all of that era, and many obscure, I mean, Thoreau and Emerson are the big guys, but I learned a lot about the lesser known names, the lesser well-remembered names, so
it's true.
Very interesting stuff.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So the way that I'd like to, so first of all, thanks to Pam and Jenny for bringing me here, and I'd like to sort of lead this in a sort of informal way, since we're such a small group, but go for about an hour and mix it up a little bit. So if you have any burning questions that you have about Thoreau, I probably can sort of field those. If you don't, if you have no exposure to Thoreau, you'll know a little bit more by the time you leave.
I just have a question on his pronunciation. I heard it say
is, so the
Thoreau.
Proper name is Thoreau, or I can't even say it because I'm so accustomed to saying it. Thoreau, but if you just say a thorough, it's just like a thoroughgoing reading of something. So the proper pronunciation is what you said. What everyone says is Thoreau. So away we go. So Thoreau was born in 1817, and he witnessed basically the growth of the Industrial Revolution through New England. What we know Thoreau today, or what we think about Thoreau when we think about Thoreau today, is him being the principal environmentalist from 19th century America. But what I want to talk about today a little bit is what I call the sort of existential roots of Thoreau's journey. So in other words, at the beginning of my intro class to philosophy, intro to philosophy, which I teach every term, I ask three questions. Who are you? Where do you come from? And why are you here? And these are the principal existential questions that we think about as human beings. Thoreau was driven by these questions, and he thought about philosophy not necessarily as an academic pursuit, but as a thoughtful way of thinking through the business of living. So philosophy wasn't meant for other philosophers. It was just meant for average, everyday folks thinking through the tough questions of being human. That's what it was. That's why Thoreau and Emerson, his mentor and friend, didn't necessarily want to be called philosophers, the title philosopher, because they thought that it was actually that the discipline of philosophy was taking them away from the very simple questions of being human. And you come to think through these questions of being human, especially for Thoreau in times of depression, anxiety, and tragedy. And he was no stranger to any, you know, to these three sort of psychic phenomena. So we think about Thoreau as going to the woods to live deliberately, to sort of get at the marrow of life at Walden, July 4th, 1845. But 2 years before that, he had taken a river trip up the Merrimack River, the Concord and Merrimack River, up to New Hampshire. And he took that trip with his brother, John. And Thoreau had just graduated from Harvard, and they basically thought about what was it to live independently? What was it to live self-sufficiently? Emerson, in his famous 1841 essay, Self-Reliance, says, "Trust thyself, every heart vibrates to that iron string." And Thoreau was trying to think about what that might mean up in the wilderness of New Hampshire. So up the Concord and Merrimack they go, they have a very nice time, and they come back down. Thoreau says that the wind was blowing very nicely that day, and they made very good time down the river to Concord. Both Thoreau and both Henry and John take up as educators or schoolmasters at a local school, and they have a school outside of Concord. And then a year after the Merrimack trip, John is shaving. I'm getting to a point, don't worry. John is shaving, and he cuts his finger with his razor, and he contracts gangrene, and he dies in Henry's arms. Takes basically a week, and Henry witnesses his brother die. That is a type of moment that gets you thinking about existential questions. So who are you, where did you come from, and why are you here? And that's actually one of the motivations for Thoreau to head out to Walden. It wasn't this environmental lark of, oh, let's live closely with nature and hang out and be a tree hugger initially. It was, let's go and see what the essential facts of life are, and how what seems like a very fleeting life, in the case of John, could actually mean something quite significant. So that's why when I read Walden, it was actually meant first as an elegy. It took 9 years to write, or rather, it took 9 years from 1845 to 1854 to be published. While he is at Walden, he's considering the death of his brother John, and asking himself the hard question of, what is it to be human given the fact that we die? So that's not a really, you know, it's not like an upper for the evening, but it actually, if we're to be honest, that's what Walden in part, at least, is about. What Thoreau discovers at Walden is that there are many ways of making human meaning. One of those ways is to simply be out in nature. And to feel connected with something slightly bigger than yourself. Okay, so I'm going to stop there and sort of then jump. So I'll jump ahead and talk a little bit about the book, and talk a little bit about the book and American philosophy, and connect it back to Thoreau. What this book does is actually gives the history of American transcendentalism, so Thoreau and Emerson, and then the history of American pragmatism, the work of William James at Harvard. To show how they're continuous between transcendentalism and pragmatism. What's interesting is that William James, who's writing at Harvard in the first decade of the 20th century, he's actually considering much of the same questions that Thoreau did. And he was Ralph Waldo Emerson's godson. And there's this tight connection between the transcendentalists at Concord and the pragmatism that James writes about. So you'll feel like I'm going away from Thoreau for a little while, and then I'll come back, okay? So I'm gonna tell you two stories, okay? One is, and this sort of creates the frame for this book, and then I'll read a section about Thoreau for you to sort of round up the evening. So I'll tell you two stories. In April of 1895, 70 years after, no, or rather, I'm sorry, 50 years after Thoreau goes to Walden, William James is asked, William James being the founder of American Pragmatism, but also the founder of experimental psychology down at Harvard. He's asked to come to the Cambridge YMCA, or the Harvard YMCA. And the Harvard YMCA is meeting at this place called Holden Chapel. It's the smallest and third oldest building on Harvard's campus. And he's going to give a lecture called Is Life Worth Living? That's what James is invited to speak on. So he walks across the yard to Holden Chapel, and he knows that usually we describe, or we answer this question in two mutually exclusive ways. There's the yes, and there's the no, okay? If you answer no, you do away with it. If you feel it strongly enough, you do away with yourself. If you answer yes, well, you go on living quite happily. But James, who, like Thoreau, had been sort of plagued by depression and anxiety and thoughts of suicide for much of his life, comes up with a third response. And he says, maybe. He doesn't say yes, he doesn't say no. He says, maybe it depends on the liver. Which, for a very long time, I was a philosophy graduate student, and in 2009, I was on a postdoc at Harvard studying American philosophy. For a very long time, I thought, that was a rubbish answer. Maybe? Depends on the liver? Give me the yes every day of the week. Just give it to me. But James actually made more sense. Because in the fall of, in the spring of 2009, I had a sort of Thoreauvian moment with his brother John. I was there at Harvard on a postdoc trying to write a book on William James. And I had always thought that James's pragmatism, pragmatism is the style of philosophy that says pragmatism is judged on the, or rather, truth is judged on the basis of its practical consequences. It was a you can do it philosophy, a sort of hands-on active philosophy. And I had always thought that it was very optimistic. And I sort of overlooked James's comment of the maybe. Maybe it depends on the liver. So in the spring of that year, my brother called me up. This is the beginning of the book. My brother calls me up while I'm writing this book on James. And my brother was a surgeon, is a surgeon, was at the time on a surgery fellowship down in New York City. And he says, you better come down to New York City. I just saw Jan. And Jan is the Americanized version of Jan, and Jan was my father. And I hadn't seen him in 12 years. And Matt said, you better come down here right now. Because I just saw Jan, and he's not going to make it for very much longer. And he was right. Jan had contracted esophageal cancer, and he was gone in March. My brother called in February. And in a little hospital up in Buffalo, New York, I watched my father die, much the same way that Thoreau had watched his brother die. And then James's answer, maybe it depends on the liver, made a little bit more sense. So yes doesn't always make sense all the time. In times of tragedy or great trouble, we experience life as a question, not as an answer. We experience life as something that is in jeopardy. Rather than answer straightforwardly. And I stopped my work on that James book. I didn't get anything done in the rest of that spring. And then somehow, don't worry, we're getting back to the Thoreau and philosophy. Let me just say this. That Thoreau at the beginning of Walden says, in most books, the I is omitted. In other words, the first person pronoun. The I is omitted. In this, it will be retained, and that is the principal difference. That's what Thoreau says in his Walden. And I take that very seriously. Philosophy is personal. It's supposed to help you through your hardest times. It's not self-help, or if it is self-help, it's really smart self-help. Okay. So anyway, back to the story, and then we'll get back to Thoreau. So in the fall of 2009, I was, I don't know how, but given a tenure track job in philosophy at the University of Massachusetts Lowell. I was really happy, or I was supposed to be really happy. I wasn't, I was still getting over the issue in the spring. William James died in 1910. I was asked to organize a conference on William James's life up in Shikorawa, New Hampshire, up in the White Mountains. It's a little south of Conway, New Hampshire. That's where William James had his summer home. He, like Thoreau, believed that philosophy should be done out of doors, on the move, walking, that there was an intimate connection between walking and life, or walking life and thinking. And William James did it up in Shikorawa. So we were supposed to have this conference in 2010 to celebrate his 100-year anniversary. And I was one of the principal organizers of this. So I go up to Shikorawa, and I start meeting with people. And I step into this little German bakery up in Shikorawa, New Hampshire. And I bump into a guy, a very old guy, 91 years old, by the name of Bun Nickerson. You can't make this stuff up. So Bun Nickerson. Bun Nickerson said to me, he goes, "What do you do, young fella?" And I said, "Well, I'm a philosopher," sort of bracing myself for the awkward silence that usually comes after that. And he said, "Oh, I knew a philosopher once." And I said, "You are not old enough to know William James." And he said, "No, I didn't know William James, although I do know of him. But I lived on the land of William Ernest Hocking." Now, William Ernest Hocking is not anybody that most people would know. But thankfully, one of my teachers had taught me that Hocking was one of William James's last students. Don't worry, this gets more interesting. Okay, so, don't worry, here it comes. So, Bun said to me, "You should go up and see the estate, the Hocking estate. It's on 400 acres of pristine White Mountains wilderness up in Madison, New Hampshire. You should go up and see it. There's a big mansion up there, and there's a library." And I'm thinking, library? Like, when I think library, I think like this library. But in the 19th century, people had real libraries, right? And intellectuals had real libraries. And one of the questions that people were faced with when they died was, what were they going to do with all their books? And so what William James and the Transcendentalists did is that they gave them to their students. And at the beginning of the 20th century, William Ernest Hocking inherited 5 significant collections from his teachers and his teachers' teachers. So Emerson, Thoreau, William James, T.H. Huxley, and Josiah Royce. And he had those books. And he put them in a non-winterized stone building up in the middle of the White Mountains, New Hampshire. Bun took me up there that day. We drove up in his blue Dodge pickup truck. And remember, I had just watched my father die, and I was thinking, anything's going to be more interesting than my life back in Boston. Because my life back in Boston was just memories of what just happened with my father and a marriage that was not going very well. In fact, we were in the process of getting a divorce at the tender age of 30. So, Bun took me up there, and on the first day, no one was around because the Hockings only summered there. So, it was fall of that year. And Bun says, "Why don't you go look around?" And so I got out of the Dodge pickup truck, and I went up to the library, and I tried the door, and it was open. And on the first day, I went and I trespassed. And thank goodness the Hockings forgave me my trespasses and allowed me to go in. Because what I found inside the library was not only the libraries of William James, parts of Emerson's library, parts of Thoreau's library, but also, Hocking was a collector of rare books from the 17th and 18th century. So, first edition Hobbes, the Thomas Hobbes, the Leviathan, first edition Descartes, that their first edition Kant, all of first edition Immanuel Kant, a philosopher from the late 18th century. All of these books just hanging out in a non-winterized open library in the middle of the White Nuns. So, I contacted the Hocking family, and I asked to come up, and I made this little library my home away from home, and this is where I learned about transcendentalism and pragmatism, again, pretty much for the first time. And the way I learned it this time was in the following way. So, Ralph Waldo Emerson in 1841, Henry David Thoreau's principal mentor in Concord. In 1841, Ralph Waldo Emerson writes the first series of it, what's usually called the first Emerson's first series. And in this series of essays, a very famous essay known as Self-Reliance, which I mentioned earlier. And it's about radical independence, okay? It's about freedom. It's about live free or die sort of thing. Classic New Hampshire, okay? When you read Self-Reliance, you think to yourself, I can be somebody, and be somebody all by myself. And I had gotten that. When I was growing up, I got it. I got that story. Most Americans do get that story. It kind of fits with their general understanding of what it is to be an American. It's like, yeah, independence. But unfortunately, if you take that story too far, it can have radically bad consequences in your interpersonal relationships. It turns out it's not all about you. So Emerson intended Self-Reliance to be written with, or to be read with, what he calls a sister essay, known as Compensation. Now, I had missed this the first time that I had read Emerson. I was like, what are you talking about? Like, Compensation has nothing to do with Self-Reliance, it seems. Compensation says no matter how free you are, no matter how independent you think you are always working and living in a greater social, political, and cosmic order. You never get free of that. Okay? And these two essays, Emerson believed, were to be read together. So it's about freedom, but it's then also about togetherness. That's the story that I began to figure out through my second reading of Transcendentalism or Pragmatism in the beginning of 2009. And that's what I discovered at Westwind, which was Hocking's estate. So over the next 3 years, I went up repeatedly, more than 36 times to Westwind. And made it my home away from home. But I also began to take someone else up to Westwind. And so it is properly American philosophy, a love story. So it's a love story. So here's the interesting part, or what some people think is the interesting part. I think you just broke connection. Are you okay?
No, you want to
bounce that. What's that? My water
bottle? Yeah, you're good.
One is okay. So, so when I was hired at UMass Lowell, there was one position open in philosophy. And I'm not going to, maybe I'm giving this all away. You should read the book anyway. Even if I give it all away, you should read the book. So when I was hired in philosophy at UMass Lowell, there was one position, okay? And there were a lot of applicants. But thankfully, a line, an employment line in economics fell through. And the chair of my department, philosophy, went to the dean and said, since you have this line falling through in economics, why don't you hire our two top candidates? We have this man, and we have this woman that we both really like. So it turned out that on my first day at UMass Lowell, I met my competition, and her name was Carol Hay. And Carol Hay was also married at the time, and we became very good friends. And then in the course of the next 2 years, she got a divorce. And then she started coming up to Westwood with me. And then we fell in love, and now we have a 5-year-old. So that's the love story part. So the book is in part about allowing American philosophy the writings of Emerson, Thoreau, and the pragmatists inform what it is to have a relationship, okay? Because they had a lot of smart things to say about dealing with one another, and so that's in part what the book is about. So over the course of the three years, Carol and I spent most of our time cataloging and saving books, okay? So one of my favorite stories about the library is Carol, we had gotten an appraiser to come up and appraise the books so that they could be donated to University of Massachusetts Lowell, which they were. On the day that the appraiser came, we had already been working there for 6 months. I thought that we had covered almost everything, that we had gotten all the books. And she pulled out this very small postcard-sized book. And on the spine it said, "A Reply to Filmer." And I was like, I've never heard of that book. A Reply to Filmer? And then she opened it up and she said, "This doesn't have an author, but it says Two Treatises on Civil Government, 1690. And it's the first edition of John Locke's Two Treatises on Civil Government from 1690. Basically, what formed the basis of the Declaration of Independence. And it was sitting, just hanging out, right there. And she pulled it out that last day that we were there. So what I'm going to do is I will read a teeny bit of the book, and this only goes for an hour, so I will read a bit of the book. I'll read a bit from, I know it goes fast. Seriously. So imagine how fast the book's going to go. So I'm going to read a little bit of the book, and I picked a selection from Thoreau. And then if we get through that, you can ask questions either about Thoreau or Emerson, and then I have another selection about a woman by the name of Pauline Goldmark, who was William James's, I won't say lover, but who was William James's, who informed William James's conception of love, let's just put it that way. So I'll read for 6 minutes, and then I'll just take some questions, and you can say, "Hey, I wanted to know more about Thoreau. Tell me," and I'll tell you. But I'm going to read it to you for a little while. So just to give you a little context, when I went up to West Wind, most of the time I spent in the library. But as I went through the books from Thoreau's library and Emerson, it became quite clear that I was spending time in the wrong place. Like right outside, like right in the fields, is where I should have been hanging out according to Thoreau. He says, go outside, like learn from the bean fields, learn what the bean fields can tell you. I missed it for a long period of time. I was just sitting like this in the library, trying to figure out the mystery of American philosophy. But I eventually figured it out. And one of the people who helped me figure it out was William Ernest Hocking's granddaughter, Jennifer Hocking. She's 50, give or take 10 years. And she lived there. She lived in a farmhouse on the estate, but not in the mansion, not in the large mansion. And she was scything one day, hand scything a field. And for some reason, I asked her to help, if I could help. And it was by far one of the more instructive philosophical moments that I had, rather than sitting in the library like this. And I came to understand Thoreau a little bit better. So I've just met this. This is half memoir, obviously, half American intellectual history. So it's told in the first person. And I have just met Jennifer outside the library. And I had gone for a swim, and it was November, gone for a swim down in a pond on the property, and I was freezing, and she had caught me sort of getting back into the library where I slept, not caught me, but found me as I walked back, and I was in pretty bad shape. I was pretty depressed because I wasn't with Carol at the time. I was going through a divorce and still thinking about my father. So that's the context. And she said, she said, "Let's have dinner at the lower farmhouse in a little while. I have something cooking down there." I nodded and said something that I hope sounded vaguely impressive about what I planned to accomplish in the library in the meanwhile. Okay, sounds good to me, she said, turning to leave. I'm going to scythe this afternoon. Suddenly, the idea of helping Jennifer scythe felt vastly more important than working in the library. So I asked if she could use a hand. Of course, she didn't need one. Saviors like Jennifer and the man, another man that I met earlier that day, didn't need any help at all. They were self-sufficient all by themselves. But Jennifer heard the underlying plea and said, sure, that'd be great. This time I felt myself making a better show of smiling. Turning to the car, I must have gestured for her to get in. I thought we had to drive to the farmhouse. It's easier to walk, she said matter-of-factly. Thoreau rode walking in 1851. Over the next decade, he would lecture on this essay a dozen times, more than any other. It was, by many accounts, his favorite. He writes, let me live where I will, on this side of the city, on that side of the wilderness. And ever I am leaving the city more and more and withdrawing into the wilderness. Once my shirt was back on from my pond excursion, Jennifer and I started down the dirt road, and I was struck by my sadly narrow understanding of West Wind. Fixated on worm-ridden books and obsessed with the prospect of finding dusty artifacts, I hadn't really taken the time to appreciate the landscape supporting the library. Walking gives one many things, according to Thoreau, but one of its greatest gifts is time. In my pursuit of self-perfection, I'd taken up running in high school, long, fast, gut-wrenching sessions that left me nauseated for the rest of the day. Often I would run to the gym, tear my body apart with weights, and race home. On these outings, there was never enough time. I was always behind the clock and racing to catch up. Thoreau's walking, an activity that seemed perfectly suited to Jennifer Hawking, served a very different purpose. He writes, the walking of which I speak has nothing in it akin to taking exercise, as it's called, as the sick take medicine at stated hours, as the swinging of dumbbells or chairs, but is itself the enterprise and adventure of the day. If you would get exercise, go in search of the springs of life. Think of a man swinging dumbbells for his health, and those springs are bubbling up in far-off pastures, unsought by him, walking. For Thoreau, walking is not something one has to do. It isn't a great test of will, but walking with care requires an attention to the present that is extremely difficult to maintain. Thoreau thought there was something sacred in walking. This is why, and said, that the best way to do it was to saunter, which literally in French means to make the ground sacred. The point of walking was to move in such a way as to make the world a holy land. The destination was pointedly unimportant. Of course, you had to decide where to go, or better, how to go, but the point of walking was not to get anywhere in particular. The point, if one could call it that, was to experience the sublime in the mundane. And this experience, so common yet so rare, had intrinsic value, the sort of value that made life worth living. I looked across the valley to a distant hillside I'd never seen. Jennifer surveyed the hill carefully, as if each clearing had a role to play in some divine plan. She said, the deer sleep up here. You can see them when they bed down when you walk around in the morning. Jennifer was the one granddaughter of William Ernest Hawking, who wasn't at all bookish. She deferred to her two other sisters on matters of philosophy and never missed an opportunity to downplay her skill with words. She was quiet. I wondered what she thought about when she was walking. Where do you walk, Jennifer? I asked. She laughed. Oh, all over. It doesn't matter. She probably had her favorite jaunts, but she seemed like the type of person who could be at home anywhere, even and perhaps especially in mid-stride. She knew what Thoreau called the, quote, the secret of successful sauntering. And it was, in Thoreau's words, he who sits still in a house all the time may be the greatest vagrant of all. But the saunterer, in the good sense, is no more vagrant than the meandering river, which is all the while sedulously seeking the shortest course to the sea. The dirt road took a hairpin turn around a stand of bare apple trees and opened out into a grassy field in the middle of nowhere. Nowhere, I had to admit, was pretty damn beautiful. This, I thought, was why Robert Frost, who'd visited Hawking's West Wind often, instructed us to take the road less traveled. I remembered Frost writing that he and William Ernest Hawking had been, in Frost's words, thoughtful friends of long standing, and I hoped that I could one day say the same of Hawking's granddaughter. Anyway, it goes on from there. But it gives you a sense, it can give you a little sense of the way the piece is written. We have 20 minutes, and I'll shut up and I can answer specific questions about Thoreau or go on about Emerson or James, but I thought that maybe you'd want to, or about the book, but I thought maybe you'd want me to stop and weigh in a little bit. Give me a answer.
I have a question.
Yeah,
what's up with the, I love old houses, so what's up with the estate now? Does someone live there? Take care of it?
That's a great question. So Hawking actually built the house out of New Hampshire granite in 1932. And he was an architect by training at the University of Iowa. And the house is probably seven bedrooms. It's big. And it overlooks the presidential range of the White Mountains. And to be honest, they still just summer there.
But somebody does.
So somebody somebody takes care of it. The problem is that many of these families who inherit large properties also have lives of their own, which have nothing to do with staying up in the White Mountains. So the granddaughters live in Vancouver and Tamworth, Vancouver, British Columbia, Tamworth, which is a neighboring town to Madison, and Vermont. So, I mean, they're not on site, and so the house still remains pretty exposed. So that's the story. And there's been some talk about trying to get funds to make it into a writer's retreat, but the funds required, because I tried to figure out how much money it would require to do, and just the starting funds would be something like $2 million. And so I don't have $2 million. So that's the status.
Thanks.
William James's old house, however, is for sale right now.
Really?
It was built in 1850, and it's in Chicoro, New Hampshire, and it's also a beautiful estate. It's for sale right now. If you just type in Chicoro and William James, it'll probably pop up. So the old lover, the old house lover in you. Any other thoughts or questions? I'm happy to weigh in more. Yeah.
I wondered what inspired you to write such a personal book.
So I think, one thing is that when you have, like Thoreau, for example, if you read Walden, it is all in the first person. But what's interesting is that Thoreau spent the last 10 years of his life writing just his journal. So and it's 80,000 pages of journal. And it really inspired me to think through the relationship between biography, autobiography, and philosophy. And I think that if these books, the second of which is going to come out in September, and they sort of track a life, this is the love story, the next one's about the ambivalences of parenting and philosophy. And if I can sort of inspire people to understand philosophy as a way of living, that would be great. And I think one way to do that is to write really personal books.
Well, it seems like for these people, it really was, like you said, they weren't up in the ivory tower. They were like just going about, like you said, being human. I mean, I don't know if that's.
And it was a family. It was a family affair. It was a real family affair. So Thoreau and Emerson were friends. They occupied the same house for long periods of time. Thoreau helped him raise his kids when Emerson was away. Like, they were real friends. And it was, it's a way that we don't think very often about academia today. And I think that that's bad. Like, I would like to think about thinking through what it might mean to teach more personally, and to write more personally. What other thoughts? I can lecture if you want me to lecture. I'm just giving you a break. You have no thoughts? Have you ever worried or wondered about certain things with Thoreau that you were like, I really want to figure this out? No?
I was just wondering, you know, someplace I read about Thoreau was that his mother provided him some food?
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Yes. So let's talk about this. So one of the...
So he's not sort of out there solitary, exactly. He's...
So let me tell you a little bit about Walden and his experience in Walden. So there's this idea that Thoreau is this recluse, this serious recluse, that he went out to the vast wilderness. His one time out to the vast wilderness didn't go particularly well. He went to Mount Katahdin up in Maine. He didn't like it. He was pretty scared by it, or overwhelmed by it. That is not to say that he didn't like nature, but his experience at Walden was not like that. It was 2 miles from Concord, and he could walk home whenever he wanted. He didn't very often, but he did go home. He had his washing done, he had some food, and he would visit friends, and friends would come and visit him. So one way of reading Walden is not necessarily that you have to go somewhere remote, but that you could think about how wilderness exists right in your own backyard, right in your own neighborhood. Some of Thoreau's most famous pieces, or most poignant pieces to my mind, are his pieces about the boundary between civilization and wilderness. He has this essay called Wild Apples. And if you ever have wild apples, or if you walk in the around the community or into your local forest, you will find still wild apples. And Thoreau says that these are like the borderland between good apples and no apples. It's like this, and they taste very good when you're out in that border country. But if you bring wild apples back to civilization, they don't taste so good anymore, Thoreau says, which is true. So Thoreau is interested in what are the necessities of life. That's why the first chapter of Walden is about economy. He titles it Economy. He says, what do you really need? What are the bare essentials? And do the things that oftentimes that we think we need, are they in fact taking us away from the real necessities of life? Like the idea of shelter, or the idea of the ability to dwell in place. Economy didn't mean it. It still doesn't. The word economy does not mean a bank account. The word economy is the root of, it is the Greek word oikos, which means to dwell, which is weird, we forget that. Thoreau is reminding us, he's like, go out, live simply. He says, simplify. Just live simply and see what you really need. It turns out it's not that much. And you actually have time to do lots of things that you didn't think you had time for. So to answer your question, I mean, that was a long way of saying, see, I can just blah, blah, blah. So yes, he did go back home and have his washing done and have food. Do you think that makes him a hypocrite? I'm going to ask you, do you think that makes him a hypocrite? Some people do. My students do, for example. They're like, oh, he's a hypocrite, forget him, he was just this privileged, and they really go after him. My students up in the wall go after this guy. They're like, he's a hypocrite, he's a privileged youth, he could never do this if he was like scrounging to make ends meet. And I have to say, there's something to that criticism, right? He's not working in a factory, let's be reasonable. He went to Harvard, okay? So the criticism holds to a certain point, but I say back to my students, I say, just because you're a slight hypocrite doesn't mean that your thoughts can't be worthwhile. So that's what I sort of come back at.
Yeah, if you go with the right attitude, you don't have to be completely immersed in this solitary life. Yeah,
right.
It comes and goes. I think that's fair.
And I just ask my students, we do this thing when I teach American philosophy or when I teach transcendentalism, I have them give me their cell phones for 2 days. 2 days. I mean, I know, and you're like 30, you're like, 2 days does not seem like a lot, but trust me, my students are like, that's a lot of time. And they're like, wow, I didn't know I had all this free time. They really do have a lot of free time. Right? But just take away certain things that they think they need, and you'll be amazed, I think.
Yeah. But don't you think, too, that maybe his trip out there, deciding to do that, was part of his grieving process of his brother?
I think so, too. Yeah, absolutely.
And he might have still done it, but not.
Right.
If his brother hadn't died, maybe he'd have done it
later,
or maybe not at all, or maybe different.
And also,
it was kind of part of that.
Yeah. And when you confront tragedy like that, when somebody dies in your presence, you really do have this moment of, oh, all of the stuff that I thought was important isn't so important anymore. It's really not. And so again, I ask my students, like, what would you do if you knew you had, 2 hours left to live? Their answer is not, I would play on my cell phone, or like, I would not text. I wouldn't be texting my last 2 hours. It's just true. And so to watch your brother die like that kind of wakes you up to, well, our time here is very limited. Why don't we try to make it sacred? Or not, maybe. Well, in Thoreau's verse, probably something like sacred. Why don't you try it? Yeah.
Thoreau didn't live that long a life either, did he?
He didn't.
Yeah.
Right? And I mean, I oftentimes made fun of Thoreau for his neck beard, but I never knew this. He was sickly for most of his life, and that neck beard was meant to keep his throat warm from tuberculosis, and he died of consumption. I didn't know that until I read Laura Wall's book on Thoreau, right? And yeah, and he didn't live very long at all. Emerson, in his eulogy to Thoreau, says, basically, Thoreau sometimes wasted his life. He could have done more with his life. But I think in this point, Emerson missed the boat. Thoreau actually spent a very rich life. He didn't travel a whole lot, but he knew his locale in a way that very few of us do. So if you think about 10-mile radius of Raleigh, do you really know this area? Like, do you know the ins and outs of it? Have you attended to every little creeper? Well, every little frog peeper. Thoreau did. I mean, he was very, very aware of his surroundings. Every, as Emerson would say, sensorial nuance. Every little nuance. So.
I think something that is hard for us is to get away from the noise. Not only the noise of our cell phones, but just the noise of life rushing all around us.
Yeah, I think that's right.
And when you can, go for a walk, go for a bike ride, go sailing, wow.
Yeah.
Something different happens.
I was reading last night, I'm thinking about writing another book about American philosophy, and I was reading Emerson's essays from the 1860s. Or not essays, I'm sorry. I was reading a journal from the 1860s. And he says that nature hides in two ways, with her darkness and with her light. And I never understood what he said by light. On darkness, I kind of get nature, it's hard to see in the dark. But he says, in daylight, nature hides because we're so often distracted by our everyday pursuits. Mm-hmm. In other words, that what we think is urgent, immediate, and important might not be. We might just be going through the habits of our lives. So when light comes on, I know what I'm doing. I'm getting my 5-year-old dressed. I'm doing this. I'm doing it, which are necessities. But Emerson asks, and Thoreau also asks, like, what are you missing in the process? What do the habits of your life sometimes obscure? I think it's a good question. Yeah. Another thoughts you have? Wow, we just burned an hour. Another thoughts? I know, see? It moves, and doesn't it? Time flies when one has fun. What do you think? Any other thoughts or questions? Come on. Let me ask you, why'd you end up coming here tonight? Other than it was just fun. The libraries were good places to go.
I know very little about these people.
Oh, okay.
Very general knowledge, so.
Yeah, my students don't know a whole lot either. So, I mean, let me say this just to create a little bit more context. So the American Transcendentalists are responding to probably the most significant point of response would be to the Industrial Revolution. The idea that technology will make our lives better, more efficient, that progress is, you know, that progress will be mechanized and will necessarily spread across the country. Mm-hmm. Thoreau and Emerson were nonplussed by this idea. They were not particularly happy with this idea. Similarly, they were deeply, the idea that independence was achieved only in 1781, or, you know, 1775 to 1781, that it was simply a political independence, was wrong to them. So it wasn't simply that, oh, we got the birth of a nation, we got our independence politically, and that, done. Independence and freedom is achieved. Emerson and Thoreau were like, no, let's have a personal revolution, a revolution of conscience. Or let's talk about individual freedom. What does it mean to live freely, maybe within a free country, but what does it really mean? And this is why Thoreau was so interested in the abolition movement, and so too with Emerson. Why Thoreau and Emerson were both abolitionists. Because we had achieved our independence, but it seemed like this whole cross-section of society hadn't achieved their independence. And this is where sort of Emerson and Thoreau